In this section, we want to look at some of the experiments and ideas that led us to our modern understanding of atoms. But before we do that, we want to talk a little bit about chemistry in general and get an idea for kind of how a reaction works and what an atom is and stuff like this. So here we have copper. And you could see the macro version of copper if you literally look at a penny. And before 1982, pennies were made completely of copper. And basically, macro scale, the scale you're usually familiar with, you know what a penny looks like. But if you were to blow this up all the way down to the atomic level, what you would see is that there's all these atoms of copper next to each other. In a single penny, there's 3 times 10 to the 22 copper atoms, approximately. This is a massive number of atoms. This is more money than if you converted all money to pennies, all the wealth on Earth, and converted to pennies. This would be more than that number of pennies. So it's a huge number of atoms, and this is the atoms in a single penny. And so these are very, very small. And what chemistry is really studying change, what happens to atoms during reactions when they change from atoms or molecules to other atoms or molecules. Copper can interact with other things, such as oxygen. So here we have a different compound. And notice that at the macro scale, it's very different. This copper oxide, copper 2 oxide, is a black powder, versus copper is a shiny metal. So these have very different physical properties. Also, we have, at the molecular level, differences as well. Instead of just copper atoms next to each other, we have now copper atoms next to oxygen atoms next to copper atoms. So we've changed both the physical properties at the macro scale and also the compound that exists. If you think about this in terms of rust, where iron interacts with oxygen, we all know that a rusty car has different properties than a new car. So the new car, there's iron, and it's solid and good to go. As over time, that iron interacts with oxygen, it forms rust, and that is not solid. And eventually, of course, the car will no longer be functioning as a car. So if we wanted to depict this as a chemical reaction, we could show it here at the macro scale. So here, looking at this, we have oxygen in this jar, and we have some copper in this jar, and slowly over time, or if you add heat or whatever, you can form a compound where these two things start to interact with each other. And this is really what chemistry is. We have the atoms, oxygen, and copper, forming the compound copper 2 oxide. And at the macro scale, this is kind of what this looks like. If we look at this a little bit more detail, we might think of it as a chemical reaction. And this is not the exact chemical reaction, but it gives you the idea. We have the starting materials, where the green is next to the green and the blue is next to the blue, often called the reactants. And then over here on the right side, we have the products, where now the green and the blue are interacting with each other. Greens were interacting with greens, blues were interacting with blues, and now blues are interacting with greens. This is what chemistry is. And here, as we'll point out several times in this course, nomenclature becomes important. Over on this side of the reaction, we call this the reactants. And over here, we call it the products. So the left is the reactants, the right is the products. In words, this arrow is yields. So reactants or starting materials yield product or products. In this case, there's just one product. So this is basically something that you'll see over and over and again in this course, including just in a few minutes. The next thing we want to talk about is kind of the structure of an atom. And we want to look at some of the ideas and experiments that allowed scientists to come up with the structure of an atom. And it's really important to remember that these theories that we learn in the general chemistry course almost always come out of experiments. So a series of experiments are done, and those experiments allow scientists to come up with and tweak theories about what's going on. However, we often teach you the theory first and then show you the experiment second, because it's easier to understand that way. But it's important to remember that the experiments did come first. We didn't know what an atom was and then set out to prove it. We did experiments, and those experiments led us to what an atom was. However, because it's easier to first explain what it is, and you're probably already familiar with it, I do want to review that briefly. You will see a slide similar to this again later on in this chapter when we actually finish talking about the experiments that led scientists to believe that this was what an atom is. So here we have a model of an atom. We have this electron cloud on the outside, which is negatively charged and carries, in this case, two electrons. This is helium. We have the protons and the neutrons. The protons are positively charged and the neutrons are neutral in the dense nucleus. And on the outside, again, is the electrons. The electron, the proton, and the neutron are subatomic particles that make up an atom, in this case, helium. They have a location, a charge, a mass, and in different units. Okay, they have a unit charge, and then they have a mass in AMU, they also have a mass in grams, and a charge in coulombs. So you don't need to memorize this table at this point, but what you do need to remember is that in the center of an atom is a dense nucleus that contains the protons and the neutrons, and on the outside is the electrons. Now I want to look at some of the ways that scientists figured out that this is what matter is made of. For thousands and thousands of years, nobody really knew that this is what how nature worked. So let's look at how they figured that out. One of the first things we want to look at is the law of definite proportions by Proust. So here we have a compound, isooctane, and it's decomposed into carbon and hydrogen. So they're actually performing this type of reaction. I should point out that this is not a balanced chemical equation, but that's not important here. If you had chemistry before, don't worry about it. We will talk about that later on. So in this case, these are just three examples. In this case, they had a 17.7 gram sample, and the next case a 27.52 gram sample, and the last case a 23.04 gram sample. And the point is that if they figured out the mass of carbon and the mass of hydrogen in each sample when they decomposed it, they found that the ratio was, for each of the samples, 1 gram of hydrogen to 5.33 grams of carbon, independent of the amount of sample that they did. Even if they did a kilogram or 10 kilograms, that's a little bit much to be doing this reaction with. However, no matter which amount of this isooctane they chose, they got the same ratio of hydrogen and carbon. And this is the law of definite proportions. This is very important because it tells scientists that there's a more fundamental building block, which is why you get a constant proportionality. Where that went next is the law of multiple proportions. And here we have this green stuff, which is CuCl. For every one copper, there's one chloride. And here we have this brown stuff, which is CuCl2. For every one copper, there's two chlorides. And if you took a 100 gram sample of each of these, you would find that for the CuCl sample, there was 1.79 grams of copper for every 1 gram of chlorine, if you decompose this. In this case, for CuCl2, copper 2 chloride, if you decomposed it, there would be 0.898 grams of copper for every 1 gram of chlorine. And the law of multiple proportions says that there's a simple whole number ratio between these. So if we take the 1.79 grams and we divide by the 0.898 grams, we find a simple whole number ratio of 2, which tells us that it's again evidence that there are atoms that combine in simple whole number ratios, because this has twice as many chlorines as this, so we see this multiple proportion as such. So later, slightly later, this came up with Dalton's atomic theory in the early 1800s. And his atomic theory said, and is surprisingly accurate even today, matter is composed of exceedingly small particles called atoms. And these atoms are the smallest subunit of matter. An element consists of only one type of atoms, and that type of atom is both unique and identical. So what that means is all hydrogens behave exactly like all other hydrogens. They're identical, but they don't behave the same as other elements like helium or oxygen or any of the other elements on the periodic table. atoms of one element differ in properties from atoms of all other elements. We already said that. So hydrogen is different than helium, is different than oxygen. A compound consists of two or more elements combined in small whole number ratios. So if you have these small whole number ratios, like 1 to 1 in CuCl and 1 to 2 in CuCl2, these atoms form compounds. And finally, atoms are neither created nor destroyed during a chemical change, but they are instead rearranged. This is super important. If you start a reaction with hydrogen and oxygen and form water, you can't turn the hydrogen and oxygen into copper or nitrogen or any other element. You can only simply rearrange them. So instead of hydrogen bonded to hydrogen and oxygen bonded to oxygen, oxygen and hydrogen are bonded, H2O, to form water. So these Dalton's atomic theory is pretty good. It is important to note that in a nuclear reaction, you can actually change from one element to another. However, in a chemical reaction, that is not the case. So in a chemistry course, atoms will never change from one form to another. So you don't have to worry about that, at least in this chemistry course. Okay, so if anything starts a reaction as oxygen, it will finish the reaction as oxygen. It may not be combined to the same things. In fact, it probably won't be combined to the same things. However, if it starts as one element, it stays as the same element. So these are just a little bit of the beginning theories of what allowed scientists to think about atoms. In the next section, we'll talk about some of the other studies that were done to figure out the mass and the charge on electrons and protons and neutrons, and the location of these things that led us to our modern understanding of the atom.